Shaw Cable, dedicated to the community, service, and you, proudly presents Spotlight on UNBC, the University of Northern British Columbia.
Brought to you in part by Northland Chrysler Jeep and Northwood Pulp and Timber Limited.
Northland Chrysler Jeep, home of the number one selling minivan in North America, is located at 3rd and Vancouver in Prince George. Northland has been in business since 1984. Northland Chrysler Jeep is a proud sponsor of Spotlight on UNBC, a program designed to let you know what's happening at your university. Northland Chrysler Jeep, your Eagle and Dodge truck dealer, is where people make the difference. Northwood Pulp and Timber is a proud sponsor of Shaw Cable 10 and its volunteer-produced television programs. Northwood also supports UNBC. As a partner in progress, Northwood has donated $350,000 towards the scholarship fund. When matched by the government, it represents a contribution of $700,000.
Hi, I'm Rob Van Attercombe, and welcome to another action-packed Spotlight on UNBC. As promised last month, this program will include a guided tour of each building on the Prince George campus. Over the next half hour, we'll also take you to Big Sky Country for a look at how UNBC might fit in the Peace River region. And also, the 1992-93 academic year has come to a close, so the attention now turns towards September 1993. That story is coming up next on Spotlight on UNBC.
On UNBC with your host, Rob Van Attercombe.
Students will eventually fill this classroom being built on the Cranbrook Hill campus, but UNBC already has about 70 students who have been taking courses as part of the Fall 1992 Winter 93 program. That academic year has just come to a close, but it'll be joined by another year of quick starts coming up this September. This past academic year has featured a total of 9 third-year courses in English, history, and psychology. Face-to-face teaching has been available in Terrace, Dawson Creek, Fort St. John, and Prince George, but many students have also taken courses through distance education. That distance format has allowed students from throughout Northern BC to take UNBC courses, often listening and contributing to the lectures over the phone. History teacher Bob Rutherdale says the initial UNBC experience for the students has been positive.
Well, I think the courses have introduced them to topic areas that have stimulated their interest, and some would like to go on and take senior seminars, perhaps, in the course areas that I've offered, or perhaps take other courses that are related to the areas I've offered. In essence, then, I think it's just stimulated their interest to go on. They're interested in the programs that will be offered, some students who are really intending to complete most of their degree here ultimately, and some are just finishing off degrees that were started elsewhere. With the Northern course, for example, that I taught, we had a section on the Provincial North, of which Prince George is a part. And many of them told me that they were able to sort of see patterns in their own experiences as Northern BC residents that correlated with what they've learned in their courses. In terms of Aboriginal history, my students found that when Chief Justin Monk or Peter Kwa as well came to visit the class, they were able to gain something from that exposure that normally they weren't aware of.
In terms of September 1993, the courses have just been approved.
Significant increase in courses this year. Last year, in the winter semester, we had 9 courses in just 3 areas, English, history, and psychology. We've expanded the offerings to include courses in all of the 4 undergrad faculties, arts and science, health and human sciences, natural resources, and business or management and administration. Courses in all of those areas, and there's 25 courses coming up in the fall semester and an additional 33 in the winter semester. The majority of the courses being offered are at the third and fourth year level, but there are some courses both at the first year level and the second year level. The choices there are a little bit limited, and that may be a problem for some students, but that doesn't rule them out from taking those first year courses, because what they can do is take courses, say, at CNC, Northern Lights, or Northwest College as a cross-registered student, meaning that they could take some college courses and some UNBC course, and they get a full load that way.
Details of the course offerings are included in the mini-calendar being sent to every home in Northern BC.
It's being sent to every household in Northern BC so that everybody in Northern BC has a chance to see what the university's offering coming up this academic year, and I think that'll be a positive thing for people to see what the university's doing.
General program information and details on the university's progress are available in the Guide to UNBC. Call 565-5666 for your free copy.
It's now time for the guided tour of UNBC's Prince George campus, and there's no better place to start than with a bird's eye view.
There you can see the library building and the south end of the Laboratory Research Center. The faculty administration building is at the top of the screen, and we're now flying over the conference center. The townhouse student residence development will be built in the wooded area off the ring road and hold just over 200 students. We took to the air in mid-March. By the time phase one was complete, several weeks later, 19,000 cubic meters of concrete had been poured. And just to put that into perspective, one cement truck holds 7 cubic meters. We're now looking northward across the campus. During the summer of 1992, there were 300 workers on site at the peak times. This summer, there will likely be about 500 workers. The entire campus and the endowment lands total about 1,000 acres on Cranbrook Hill. The first capping ceremony was held on the roof of the library building in the fall of last year, and that's where we begin our tour with UNBC's Director of Facilities, Godfrey Medhurst.
Now, we're on top of the library right now, and so where are you going to take us then on the tour?
Okay, we'll start from the administration building, which is to the left of the camera, and we'll work our way around from the administration building basement through the dining room into the agora. From the agora, we'll work through the mail room, through the print room, into the bookstore, through where the student services are underneath the winter garden, mm-hmm. which will bring us through into the basement of the laboratory building. And we come up through the laboratory building, out through all three floors of the laboratory building, down through the rotunda, which is the round portion of the laboratory building, back through the student services area in the agora, mm-hmm. and which brings us into the basement of the library, four-story building, and we'll come up through the four floors of the library.
So we'll end up right where we begin?
Right where we are right now.
Okay. So we basically go around the campus like this?
Clockwise. Yeah, halfway round, what we should do, though, is go up through the tunnel into the physical plant building, mm-hmm. which isn't actually attached to the central part of the buildings, but
yeah.
but through a tunnel access.
Okay.
And we can go up and access that building, too.
Great. So we just came from the roof of the library, and here we are now on top of the administration building.
That's correct.
The first floor of the administration building.
That's right.
So what will this building be eventually? I guess by its name, I guess basically offices.
The administration faculty building is basically, like you say, it's the first floor that we're standing on will be for the main administration of the campus. Mm-hmm. And the second and third floors will be where the deans of the faculties will have their areas, their secretaries and their personnel. Actually, there is one other floor under here, the basement, mm-hmm. even though half it's out the ground. It's the main receiving area and inventory control for the campus stores. And we're standing actually right on top of the computing center mm-hmm. with the Senate right behind us.
Okay, so this building will also have an atrium up through the middle, won't it?
That's correct, just like the library building. It won't be as big as the library building, but you can see the footings here already for the supports for the atrium, yes.
Okay, Now, this building will be three floors high. Why is it that this building isn't like the library in the sense that the library, you can already see how it's going to look, and this building is basically just one floor?
Okay, well, phase one of the construction called for all the concrete to be poured, and the library building just happened to, library and the laboratory building in the background there happened to be mainly concrete. This particular building, there'll be a lot of emphasis on wood and steel in the final construction. Therefore, all you see right now is the concrete foundations.
Okay. So next we're off to the cafeteria, which is right over there. So we just came from the administration building, which is just over there.
That's correct.
And here we are now at the cafeteria.
That's right. We're in the second level with the cafeteria. Mm-hmm. There's two levels. The area below is slightly larger than this area up here. Mm-hmm. And you access it via a spiral staircase, which winds its way around the fireplace here behind us.
Okay, so there'll be a fireplace through the middle of that.
That's right.
Or chimney, anyway.
That's correct.
And then around the outside of the fireplace, but still inside this tall structure, is where the staircase will go.
That's correct.
Okay, now both levels will be seating area?
Yes, it will. Yes, and the main servery area is right underneath us. Mm-hmm. Servery area attached to the kitchen. And they serve everything here from hamburgers right through to almost three-course meals.
So then here's the basement. That's right. And we'll go over here, which is the rest of the agora. So we just came now from the cafeteria,
right.
And here we are in the agora, and this part of the agora will be?
The bookstore.
I see.
Bookstore is right here. We're standing underneath the openings, which are going to be the sun scoops, the sun scoop where the light reflects into the this area here to bring more light into this part of the agora.
So even though there's all concrete around, there will be a lot of natural light even in this area.
That's correct, yeah.
I see.
And over in the background will be the print room and the mail room, mm-hmm. just to our left here.
So this will be a pretty high traffic area part of the campus then, I would think.
Actually, this part of the agora is where all the traffic will flow from the dining room through the student services over to the laboratory and the library building.
I see. Now, where are we off to next then?
We go to the conference center and we go up through the utilidor just in the background, around the corner here.
So this is, we're coming out of the agora now, coming on top of the agora.
That's correct.
And leading towards the conference center.
That's right.
Now the conference center, though, it's a lot of different rooms and breakout rooms and different things associated with it.
That's right. The heart of the conference center is the 350-seat actual conferencing area itself.
Yeah.
And then there's 10 breakout rooms that can, by removing some of the walls, they can turn into about three rooms.
Mm-hmm.
And that is joined to the fitness center, which we're going to see in a second.
Okay. So there will be, though, there's been a lot of complaints from people that we're not going to have a fitness area, but the university will, in fact, have some fitness facilities on site.
That's correct. Our second phase of construction, about 4 years after opening, calls for a full-blown gym, which will be over behind the administration building.
Mm-hmm.
But to start with, we will have a small fitness center here.
Yeah, consisting of?
Consisting of a weight room. An aerobics room, three international-sized squash courts, one of which can be made into a racquetball court.
Yeah.
And there's like a small gym area, big enough that you can play volleyball or a bit of basketball in.
Yeah, but no bleachers or things
like
that.
No bleachers,
yeah.
That's correct.
So this is the big lecture hall right here.
That's right, yeah, 350-seat lecture hall. You're standing roughly where the podium will be right here.
The conference center will provide a source of revenue for the university, especially during the summer months, when fewer students will be on campus and the residences can be used to house conference delegates. In 1994, for example, UNBC will host a conference of the Circumpolar Universities Association. From the top of the conference center, you can see the Winter Garden, our next destination.
So here we are now in the Winter Garden, and this will all be covered by glass here, right?
Just like a greenhouse. This will stick up through the agora roof.
Yeah.
That's right.
Now, what's all in here?
Okay, down below on our left here is the... actually, all this area is where the students will interact mainly.
Mm-hmm.
Starting over by the front there is the fireplace that looks out onto the courtyard.
Yeah.
And then there's a video games room. There's a small deli down here, which will be a snack bar deli during the day, and bar at night. There's the student union offices, I believe, just below us here.
Yeah.
There'll be their radio room, and the main area where they can sit around and really interact.
From the Winter Garden, we make our way through the utility corridor, or utilidor, to the physical plant building.
Now here we are in the physical plant, your favorite building on campus.
That's right, Rob, my favorite building.
Why? What's so great about this building?
Well, I look at it as the heart of the campus because from here, we feed out the hot water system that's going to heat all the buildings in the campus. Mm-hmm. There's going to be three gas-fired boilers sitting right here,
yeah,
which will, on a loop system, pump water out to all the buildings in the campus and then return to be reheated. Also, in the summer, we will have an absorption chiller that will keep all the buildings air-conditioned.
I see.
And as well as that, this being the heart of the campus, we have a building management control system which controls all the air handling systems, all the lighting for all the various rooms, right from this one building. So you can see why this building is very important.
So, but nothing basically on campus would work if this
building
wasn't functioning.
That's right, Rob.
Okay. Now, right next door to this building is the laboratory, and that's where we're heading next.
That's right.
And this may be your favorite building, but that one
is yours.
Is my favorite building.
Oh, it's a nice building too.
So now here we are in the rotunda of the laboratory building. And this basically takes us up from the first floor, which is down there, or the basement.
The basement.
And to the first floor, which is this floor, second and third floors.
That's right, there's four levels here.
Yeah, so what's all in this building? It's pretty self-explanatory by its name, but...
Okay, the rotunda splits the building into two halves. There's a north end, mm-hmm, and the south end. In the south end, in the basement, is the main campus locker room, where all the students better use their lockers.
Okay.
And then on the first floor here, just like research offices, computerized research labs. On the second floor is the main special equipment room where all the instruments like the electron microscope and the NMRs will be housed. In the top floor again is another computerized research lab.
Okay.
In the north end, in the basement, there's some maintenance shops, acid neutralizing pit, there's storage area for chemicals. And the first, second, and third floors in the north end are our three main labs, low, medium, and highly serviced laboratories for experiments.
Okay. What's a low service laboratory?
Well, they're just basically benches with very few services.
So like your Bunsen burners, beaker-type labs.
Beaker-type thing. And then the higher up you go, the more services you get. Up to the top floor, where we have all the fume hoods, mm-hmm, there are about 17 fume hoods. And then up on the roof will be the three main exhaust fans that carry the exhaust, the fumes out of the building.
Okay, so this building now from this floor, this is the first floor, second floor, third floor. So let's go check out some of what's available higher than this.
Okay.
The exteriors of many of the buildings will consist of split-face masonry, whereby a block is made up of the desired texture and color, roughly split down the middle and then turned inside out and affixed to the outside walls. The connecting building, or agora, a Greek word for marketplace, opens to the plaza with walls of glass. The top of the one-story agora, however, will be landscaped.
So we just came from the top of the laboratory building.
That's right.
And now we're down here in the Royal Mews.
Certainly looks like the Royal Mews, isn't it? This is where, yeah, actually this is where the Queen keeps her horses.
Okay.
Not.
So now we're over to the library. No, this is really the student services area.
This is, yeah. We're standing in the student street right now, mm-hmm, in the north end of the Agora. There's a big skylight that runs the full length of the student street here to bring light down into these two areas.
Yeah.
In this area here is the main registrar's office where all the students can come to register and where they come to pay all their bills. Mm. There's co-op education, learning assistance. There's a small chapel down here.
Yeah.
The First Nations building is just over there.
Okay.
And mainly this is where students come to get help on anything that they require in the campus.
This is really architecturally interesting too with the archways.
It is, yes. It makes a nice feature. Real nice feature.
The library is right next door to us here.
Right.
So that's, I think, where we're off to next, right?
That's right.
Okay, let's go. So here we are now in the atrium of the biggest building on campus, the library.
That's right, Rob. There's about 120,000 square feet in this building, beginning with the basement, which is where all the mechanical and electrical equipment is housed. And then the first floor is 44 classrooms.
Mm-hmm.
The second and third floor will be where our library collection of 150,000 volumes will be when we open. And the top floor, there's about 78 faculty offices.
Okay.
And you can probably see the temporary roof, which we had to put on for the snow load-in for the winter.
Yeah.
That will be replaced, of course, by the glass roof when we open the building up.
And the first floor where the classrooms are, that's the biggest floor because the building is sort of stepped, isn't it?
That's right. All our classrooms right now are in the library and the Agora, But in the second phase of the campus opening, about 4 years after we open, we hope to have a classroom block between the conference center and the physical plant building, and then all that space will become a library.
I see. So holding about 500,000 volumes, isn't it?
When it's complete, 500,000 volumes. That's right.
So now we've been in all the main buildings on campus.
That's yes, we have, and included in that 500,000 square footage of buildings that we open will be the residences.
Mm-hmm.
Over behind the physical plant building, there will be a an apartment block which will house about 280 students. And as we come into the campus, down near Shane Creek, there will be 60 townhouses which will house another 220 students and some family units there as well.
Okay, so that's the campus in a nutshell.
That basically is the campus in a nutshell.
Okay, now we're back up to the roof for a final look around.
All right.
So now here we are back up on the roof of the library with a nice view of the city of Prince George. And thank you very much for showing us around.
Oh, you're very welcome.
And what do you see us heading now over the next few months in terms of what buildings are going to be the focus of attention from the construction workers?
Well, like in the second phase, it's going to be coming on soon. We'll be working full bore on the library, laboratory, and the Agora, finishing off the physical plant building because we have to hopefully get one boiler running on manual before October.
Mm-hmm.
And then there'll be the administration building and the conference center, which we'll be carrying on with. So we have to have it all closed in, hopefully by October, so that we can work during the winter on it. And just have to pray for warm weather now for the summer.
Yep, sunny skies like this.
Sunny skies. Oh, this would be great if we had this weather all summer.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Very welcome.
With phase one of the campus now complete, the attention turns to phase two, which will take the main buildings on campus to completion. You may recall that the low bid for that contract came in about $8 million above what UNBC had budgeted for the project. And as a result, the university will be revising phase two and making some design changes to save money and keep construction on budget. All of the main campus buildings will be built, and in addition to staying on budget, it's expected that the campus will open on time in September of 1994. Pure gold have been two words to describe UNBC's acquisition of materials from Cassiar. 2,500 boxes of documentation have arrived at UNBC, telling the story of the town site in northwestern BC, which was built to serve an asbestos mine and then journeyed from boom to bust. The documents likely would have been dumped in a landfill had it not been for the UNBC initiative, and they'll eventually be housed in a UNBC archives. In the meantime, however, home will be in a warehouse in Prince George. The documents are significant because the history of northern BC is largely the history of one industry resource towns like Cassiar. At its April meeting in Prince George, the UNBC Interim Governing Council approved the appointments of several new academic staff, including the program chairs of math and computer science, psychology, social work, and forestry. One of the new faculty members appointed in the education program was born and raised near Smithers, while the new associate professor in women's studies is a former resident of Prince George. Even though appointments are being made, the interview process for academic staff is continuing, with April featuring public lectures from candidates for outdoor recreation and tourism, biology, geography, anthropology, English, chemistry, and First Nation studies.
And define an endangered language as a language no longer being learned as a mother tongue by children. A linguistic point of view, such a language is doomed to extinction. It is like a biological species that lacks a reproductive capacity. For all of North America, excluding Mexico, there are about 187 languages spoken, most of them indigenous or First Nation languages. Of those 187, 149 are endangered in this sense, or 80%.
Every once in a while, we'll hit the road to show you some of the communities in UNBC's region. UNBC and BC Hydro co-sponsored a conference in Fort St. John at the end of March, so we took the opportunity to travel to Big Sky Country.
economy of the Peace River region has long been tied to the agriculture sector, but lifetime Fort St. John resident Bill Bouffioux says low grain and cattle prices have hurt.
Agriculture is in a real downward trend right now, other than for beef cattle. And that's why you see these different people are branching out into game farming or to specialty crops to try and save the farm, basically, because the grain prices are really low. The cost of production is just going up, 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 and up. When I first started farming, you could buy a gallon of gas for 18 cents a gallon. Now it's 50 cents a liter. Now it's 20 times higher. And grain prices are virtually the same as they were in the early 60s. Beef cattle are maybe four times higher, but everything else is 10 times, 20 times higher. So,
so this community is really in transition then right now?
That's probably fair to say, yes. So people are trying to diversify, trying to get back in land so they can live off the land instead of 95% of the farmers working off the land or their wives to support the family farm.
A major driver in the local economy is the energy sector, especially the McMahon plant near Fort St. John, which directly employs 135 people. Alone, it supplies 40% of the natural gas consumed in the province.
The McMahon plant was built in 1957, and up until last year, we have produced approximately 7 trillion cubic feet of gas through this plant. Now, there's proven reserves of 35 trillion cubic feet left in this area around here. So you can make that assumption yourself. I think we're going to be here for a while.
Regional economic development was the topic of discussion during a conference co-sponsored by UNBC and BC Hydro. About 65 delegates attended the workshop, moderated by Nick Petryszak, UNBC's regional coordinator in the Peace River region.
This was the first real public event for UNBC in the Peace River area, and the attendance was just overwhelming. We had representation from all of the communities in the Peace River and the Northeast in terms of Fort Nelson, and very high level representation, and an involvement at a level in terms of dealing with basic fundamental issues that is quite gratifying to see. And I think that these kinds of events have really brought UNBC to the forefront of people's attention.
Do you think that having a representative in the Peace River region who's here as the representative of the Peace River region for the university will put sort of that human face on the
university? Definitely. I mean, people have told me that consistently. The mayors have told me that consistently in all the communities. Since coming here a month ago, I've been put now on over 13 committees. And people are really wanting to take ownership of UNBC and involve UNBC and ask UNBC's opinions at all levels. And it really does make a difference. And that human element and also the idea of a UNBC person living in the community makes all the difference in the world.
Thank you for tuning in to this edition of Spotlight on UNBC, the fourth in our series of monthly progress reports on the University of Northern British Columbia. Next month, we'll meet a UNBC employee who ran in the Boston Marathon. My name is Robin Adderkom, and I'll see you next month.